Thank you for coming to my show, Alcoholicos. look at this. It's a big theatre, man. I appreciate it coming out. People who are watching this at home might know this is a fucking Monday night, so I appreciate how many people have come. I realise that in this economy, tickets for things such as comedy shows aren't that cheap. For men, for women, same price they've always fucking been, aren't they? Women don't pay for things like this. There's women in this room who have no fucking idea how much the ticket for this show costs. No fucking idea. Your husband came home, said, remember we're seeing Jim Jeffries? You said who, and now you're fucking here. Women don't pay. Basically, women are a bunch of cunts. To summarise, women are cunts. See, I don't know if you even know that drinks cost money. You know? Ugly chicks though, if you know that drinks cost money, you're a fucking ugly bitch, but otherwise you're a good looking girl, good luck to you. See, my birthday's on Valentine's Day, so even on my fucking birthday I'm buying some bitch dinner. If I meet a nice girl and I'm in a restaurant and the check comes and I put the credit card down and she's a nice girl, she'll do the purse grab. And if I go, no, it's okay, she's very quick to give up on that argument. Other arguments she can keep going for fucking years. But that one she's ever so gracious about. This is why I think I'd like to be gay. I think gay would be a good move for me. I wouldn't enjoy the sex, I'd have to get through the sex. I would have a cock in my mouth with tears streaming down my face. And as the jizz hit the back of my throat, I'd be thinking of my happy place. But it'd be worthwhile just so I could split the occasional bill. That's why gay guys are happy, and that's why lesbians are fucking miserable. Lesbians are fucking miserable people because they have to hang out with women all day. It must be fucking horrible. They must just be sitting there at dinner going, I'm not going to pay for this, bitch. I've just worn my best plaid shirt and shaved my head. You better treat me like a princess. Now, if there's any lesbians in the room, and I assume there's not because laughter's not your thing. But if there is, I'd like to apologise for that last joke. But if you hate men so much, stop trying to look like them. You never see a Jew dressed as a Nazi. I did that joke in America. I said lesbians have no sense of humor and they're not fun or whatever. And these two lesbians stood up and stormed out of the room as if to prove my point. They're just not fun people. Gay guys are fun. I don't care how homophobic you are. If you're holding a dinner party and a gay guy shows up, you get a little bit excited. Oh, yeah. You're like, oh, fucking a gay guy. Well, strap yourself in, love. Hey, I've got a live one, right? But if you're holding a dinner party and a lesbian shows up, you're just like, ah, fuck me. All I wanted to do was relax and play Pictionary. She's drawing something political. You can't even point lesbians out, and they're so fucking obvious. It's so obvious. You can't point them out. If you saw, like, if I see, like two lesbians in the audience, I go, excuse me, you lesbians. They'll be like, what the fuck? What do you mean by that? Right? But if I see two gay guys in the audience, I go, excuse me, are you gay guys? They'll go, guilty, because gay guys fucking love being gay. The word gay comes from happy. They like fucking men in the ass so much, they've called it happy. I've been a heterosexual my whole life. I would not call the experience happy. I would call it a struggle at best. I'll tell you another reason why it must be awesome to be a gay guy. It must be wonderful to be in a relationship where if your partner's being a dickhead, you can punch him in the head. Hasn't that got to give your relationship a whole new dimension? I can't tell you the amount of arguments I've had with women that could have been sorted out quicker with a punch. And while we're on the subject of domestic violence, it's a horrible thing, of course it is. Now, you ever met a woman who's like been married like four times? She's like, I guess I just choose the wrong type of man. I've been married four times and all my husbands beat me. And you're like, all of them. All four. One, two, three, fucking four. They all beat you. Someone doesn't know how to shut the fuck up now, do they? Because I'm a tolerant man. I'll give anyone three, but four, you're a fucking button pusher. That's a nice cheery way to start the show. I do a lot of gigs, well not a lot, I do some gigs out in Iraq and Afghanistan and stuff like that, which if I was in an American crowd right now, they'd go, ooh, yeah. But I'm not, so I can be honest with you, I do it for money. The first time over there, it's like I'm king of it. The first time I go to a gig in Iraq, they find me and my manager in a passenger plane into Kuwait. Now, it turns out that Kuwait is a regular country that anyone can visit. Then, a military truck gets me and my manager and drives us over the border into Iraq and drops us off. And we're standing in the middle of the desert of a war-torn country. We can't see anything on the horizon. And I turn to my manager and go, good booking, fuckface. And then this helicopter comes in over the horizon and lands in front of us. And the blades are still going. And this soldier runs off and goes, excuse me, are you Jim Jeffries? And I went, what other white cunt were you looking for in the desert at this exact location? Then he hands me my bulletproof vest and my helmet. He's obviously wearing his bulletproof vest and his helmet. His are camouflaged. Mine, fucking blue. And I said, why do I have a blue vest and helmet? He said, that's so the enemy know you're a civilian. I'm like, does the enemy give a shit? That's my main concern, because I've never been a sniper. But every time I got off the helicopter, I surrounded by soldiers protecting me. If I was a sniper, I'd be like, the cut in blue looks important. Right? So we got in this helicopter. And we're sitting in this chopper. That's what we call them in the biz. Chopper. And I'm sitting here, and I've got two soldiers sitting next to me there. My manager, Brett's sitting there. He's got two soldiers sitting next to him. There's two soldiers in the cockpit. There's a great big door open next to me there. And there's another door open there. And at that door, there's a soldier with a great big gun on a hinge with bullets coming out of it like that thing that Chewbacca wears. And we take off and off we go to Baghdad. And as we hit the border of the city, I hear a great big bang. And these two small flares shoot out from the small wings of the helicopter, followed by a trail of smoke. And the helicopter goes Now, the reason they do this is when they get over the danger area, if there's a heat-seeking missile, it'll be distracted by the flares, and then the helicopter will fly out of range. Very clever. Now, they never told me this was happening. As far as I'm concerned, the wings have just exploded. And we're now plummeting to our death. It's nice to know how you react under pressure. Because I reacted thusly by vomiting over my lovely blue vest, ironically making it more camouflaged than it was before. And yelling out, "We're going down!" The two pilots, the soldiers, the gunner, they all start pissing themselves laughing. They're reaching through, they're high-fiving each other. It turns out they've been waiting for this joke for months. I'm cleaning vomit off myself, going, "Ah, oh, you guys are good. Thank you for defending my freedom." Hey? So I sit back down, covered in vomit, in the helicopter. And so I'm trying to look out the door to try to unqueeze myself. And I'm looking out over the ground over Baghdad. By the way, Baghdad, beautiful city, untouched. And I look out on the ground and I see a little Arab fella with a handgun shooting up with a helicopter. Just once again, I freak out. We're being fired on! The gunner now is laughing so fucking hard. He's laughing even harder than he's before. He's laughing so hard he's killed over. The gun's just dangling out in the hinge. And I'm like, "What's your fucking problem, man?" And he's like, "Jim, you're gonna have to calm down, mate. We're in a military helicopter with a bulletproof bottom. That's a handgun. We're so high up the bullets can't even reach us. They just sort of go..." And then I jokingly said, "I bet our bullets can reach him." And he went, "Oh yeah." And the little cunt died. And I was like... I was just saying, mate. Just saying. I didn't want to ruin anyone's day. Isn't that a fun story about a man dying? It's funny though, my limited time in a war zone, I didn't see what all the bad stuff was. They were very nice to me. But this was kind of crazy to me because I don't know historically how we're going to talk about it. See, like my grandfather, he fought during the Second World War for the Japs, weirdly enough. No, for the Australians. He killed a lot of Japanese, hated them till he died. "Love the food, hate the people," he used to say. What a complex man. I used to love listening, when I was a kid, listening to him tell stories about killing Nazis. There was always something exciting about it. I just don't know what I would tell my grandson about what's happened in history now. I imagine I'll be 80 years old, and I'll be sitting in my chair, and my grandson will be out on the floor looking up at me adoringly, and I'll go, "Now, there used to be these people called Arabs, and they lived in the Middle East, or as you call it, the radiation zone. In 2020, President Macaulay Culkin got really upset with the Arabs and he nuked them all. But what Macaulay Culkin and the rest of the Americans hadn't realized was that China had slowly but surely become the superpower of the world. So while the Americans were nuking the Arabs, the Chinese nuked the Americans. And that's why we have no Americans and no Arabs." And then my grandson would look up at me and go, "Mashabawa." Ha ha ha. It has the feel of racism, but you can't pick the exact moment. Like, you know it is. It's definitely racist. So let's change subject quickly. How do blind people wipe their asses? I know what you're thinking, the same as us, but you're not thinking outside the box. Because wiping your ass is a very visual activity. No one's ever just leant up, wiped, then dropped into the bowl. You wipe your check. There's a lot of poo there. I'm going to wipe again. There's still a lot of poo. It feels dry, but there's still poo. I think I left one up there. I bet that's where the dog comes in handy. I'm not saying the dog licks the blind person's ass. I'm saying these are very intelligent dogs. They would have worked out some form of barking system. So the blind guy would have the dog like sit in front of him. Woof, woof, woof. Woof, woof. Woof. And they'd probably work up some special Morse code bark for when there's blood in the poo. No, it's because they've already been through a rough time. They're blind. No need for ass cancer. Not that blood always means ass cancer. I suffer from hemorrhoids. I've done since I was 22 years old. And it's a very young age to get hemorrhoids. But there's a lot of blood involved. If you've never had one, there's a lot of blood involved in a bad hemorrhoid. I've had toilet bowls that look like abortions. It's not good. And the first time when you're 22, when you get one, your brain goes to ass cancer. You're like, oh, I got ass cancer. Because no one ever tells you about hemorrhoids when you're young. Your dad never sits you down and goes, when you get a bit older, you'll be pushing a poo a little bit hard and a small portion of your asshole will fall out. Now, it's nothing to be alarmed about. It's just part of becoming a man. So the first time I got a hemorrhoid, I didn't tell anyone because I thought I was dying, obviously. And I go to see my doctor, the same doctor I've had my whole life, and he makes me, I got ass cancer. And he makes me bend over a chair. And then he gets a rubber glove on, he sort of prods around my ass a little bit. And he goes, you've just got hemorrhoids there. And I said, I thought that only happens to old people and pregnant women. And he went, and you? So, I live in America now, and people get so entertained by that, but where else am I going to put them? We'll put that away for continuity in case they cut the jokes up differently. There we go, that's a bit of a... Because I know there's people who are sitting home going, that beer went like that, then it went like that, then it went like that. Fucking nerds. So I live in America. It's fucking blows my mind. I live in America now. I coming from Australia and everything, I never thought I'd sort of go this far with my career or anything. And I find myself now, I'm out there auditioning for major movies and shit, man. And I still feel retarded every time I go in there. Now, the first time I went for an audition, I'd been in LA for like a couple of days, and my agency sent me to this audition. And I went along and I met this girl in the corridor called Kawa. And I was really nervous, and she could tell I was nervous. And she sort of calmed me down, and we had a little bit of a chat. And she was really cute, and we flirted together and stuff. And then I read the little bit, and then I went home. And then I got a call later on that afternoon going, they loved you. You're going to come back for callbacks. I'm like, excellent, that's good. So I go back for a callback. And when you do callbacks, often they have you reading with another person. So I'm in the room reading with this girl, and it's the same girl from the corridor. It's Carla, right? And we're sort of flirting, hey, from the thing before. And so we're reading. We have great on-screen chemistry and all that type of stuff. Then after the audition, I said to her, I said, Carla, do you have any taxi cab numbers? I got to get to my next audition. She said, where are you trying to get to? And I went, Santa Monica. And she said, that's where I'm going. I'll give you a lift. Now, please note at this stage of the story, I didn't ask for the lift. We go down to the car. She gets in. She unwinds me window. She looks out and goes, Jim, what's your full name? And I went, Jim Jeffries. And she went, wait there. Then she called her mum up and said, hi, mum, it's Carla. I just met a very nice boy at the audition today, and I'm going to give him a lift. But in case I get raped or murdered, his name's Jim Jeffries. So if you don't hear from me in an hour, assume something bad has happened and call the cops. Get in, Jim! So I get in. We got like a 15-mile drive. I say fucking nothing for the first 5 miles. I just look forward. And eventually I turn to her and go, you just made this rape really awkward. She fucking freaks out. She slams her foot on the brakes. She skids off the highway. She starts slapping at me. I'm grabbing her wrist now. I feel kind of rapey and I didn't want to. And it's like, you off for the lift. I didn't ask for the fucking lift. You seem more concerned in solving this crime than preventing it. So I raped her to teach her a lesson. How else would she learn? Now let's go a little bit deeper. I suffer from depression. I have done my whole life. I've been suicidal on and off for the last sort of 10 years, and it's something that I sort of deal with on a day-to-day basis. And I'm on antidepressants, but on the box it says they don't work if you drink, so I'm not on antidepressants. But whenever I get depressed or down, I always feel like a selfish asshole for doing it, because it's really a childish act to be depressed. Do you realise that we here in the first world countries, Canada, America, Australia, Britain, not Scotland, Wales, you know, these major countries, they're all the good ones. Do you know we have a higher rate of suicide than the people of Africa? Let's just think about that for a second, right? The people in Africa, 1 in 4 of them are dying from AIDS. They're sitting in a grass fucking hut in their own shit. They walk 5 miles to get water with a fucking jug on their head. Yet they're happier than you. You're sitting at home with a fucking pantry full of food watching fucking X Factor or 700 channels go, I'm not happy! Ah! And do I know why you're not happy? Because we were brought up on dreams. And even when I said that, you're all silent, because all of you are going, you better not fuck with my dreams. You think dreams are wonderful, don't you? You think dreams are the great thing on earth. You got to have dreams. You know what happens with dreams? They don't happen. You fucking... You know what dreams are like in Africa? Don't die today. Don't die today. Don't die today. That's a real fucking dream. I'm as guilty as you, man. When I was a young comic, all I wanted to do was go on stage for 5 minutes and make people laugh. And then I thought, fuck that, man. They better pay me. And then they started paying me. And I went, I'm better than these cunts. I better be a headline act. Became a headline act. Then I went to the Edinburgh Festival. Did fucking that. And then I went, all right, I better go over to America. When I was in America, I recorded my DVD in America. And I was like, yeah, that's too fucking right. Now I want to be a movie star. And you know what? I'm not a movie star. I want to kill myself. That's retarded. I have gone further than a man of my looks or intellect should ever fucking go. And at this fucking moment, I'm in a sold-out theatre in fucking London, in the West End. This would be a dream of mine as a child. And you know what I'm going to do tonight? Cry myself to sleep. Because I was taught to dream. But you never complete your dreams. You do complete them, but then what you do, you put another one on. And then another one on. And then when you die, you'll be on the deathbed going, my dream is to see my grandkids again. Then they don't come, then you die fucking miserable. You're never going to complete all of them. No one's ever gone, oh, I've got no more dreams left, I'm fucking done. So I'm not going to dream anymore. Fuck that. I'm going to make little tiny achievable dreams that I can achieve. Like, for instance, I was drunk last night. So my dream for this evening is not to shit myself on stage. Now it might happen. It might not happen, but if it does happen, I'll wash myself off and start again because I'm a dreamer. But it's not our fault. This is bred into us. This is in our psyche. You can't fix things that have been said to you as a child. Like when we were at school, we had school teachers stand in front of every single one of us and go, if you work hard and you put your mind to it, you can achieve anything. You know what that was? That was a fucking lie. You can't achieve anything. Nobody can. Don't put that pressure on yourself. Everybody in the world has limitations. No matter how hard I think about it, no matter how hard I practice, never be in the NBA because I'm a fat white guy, not a tall black guy. Like, remember that fat fucking dumb ugly kid who couldn't fucking catch a ball? You know those kids are like if he was like one IQ smaller, he'd get benefits, but he's just on the border of retardation, right? That kid was told he could achieve anything. Right? You know what they should have done with that kid? They could have gone, boy, Kevin, you fat prick. Dig a fucking hole, you dumb cunt. All right, you fucked that up as well, but no one else wants to do it, so you got the gig, big boy. And while I'm at it, if you're a dumb, ugly cunt, and your wife or your husband's a dumb, ugly cunt, guess what your fucking kids are? Your kids are dumb, ugly cunts just like fucking you, except they're fucking super concentrate dumb, ugly cunts. Because they come from both of you into a bottleneck of fucking retardation. But you still think they're the greatest thing, don't it? You go to their soccer games, kick the ball, John, you're doing a good job, he's getting better. You should fucking lock that thing up. But it doesn't matter if you're an idiot and you're stupid and you can't fucking catch a ball and everything in your life is retarded because, you know, you'll always be welcome with God. God loves the stupid and the fucking... This is the thing about people who believe in God. They're idiots. There's no dancing around it. You're a borderline fucking mentalist. You're an idiot. You're like a 13-year-old kid who still believes in Santa. Oh, I'm still gonna get killed. Oh, fuck you. You know, it's I don't hate people who believe in God. I don't hate them, right? But I just don't want to talk to them. I don't want to be around them. It's like how I don't hate the mentally insane, right? But the mentally insane and religious people are the same fucking bag. If I'm standing in a bar chatting to either of them, eventually I'll walk away going, okay. See, do you know, I live in America, so I have to deal with this all fucking day. Okay, 85% of Americans believe in God. That's mental. Here in Britain, it's like 36%. In Australia, it's 27%. I think in Canada, it's like in the 60s. And in Russia, no one. You want to know why? Because it's fucking cold. No one believes in God. So all the Russians, they don't get to go to heaven because they were born in the wrong country. Born in the wrong country, you don't get to go to heaven. Americans born in the right country, eh? You get to go to heaven. You're born in the right place. Because God's very particular about where you're born. Right? So half of you fucking cunts get to go to heaven because you're British. A few Australians get to go. And then the Americans all get to go. And most of the Canadians get to fucking go. And then there's those dumb cunts in those muzzy countries, eh? They don't even believe in the right God. They're fucking dead. They're not going. And what about those dumb Asian fucks, eh? With that fat cunt Buddha. They don't get to go to heaven because they've made up a God that doesn't exist. And then there's the Indians with the fucking monkey elephant guy. What is wrong with them? They must be retarded. They're believing in the wrong God. Not us, though. We were born in the right country. Because God selects countries. That's why they always say, God bless America. Because the world's billions of years old. And America's 250 years old. And that's when God decided to choose a team. Dad has a webpage called Ask God where children can write questions to God. And then through the power of the internet, God will answer them. I'm a bit dubious, but So the most asked question on Ask God is, were there kangaroos in the ark? So children could ask any question in the world, but a child's mind works like this. They go, I like kangaroos. I think the ark story is bullshit, so Shazam. And the answer to that question is, although there are no mention of kangaroos in the Bible, it does state that there was two of each animal. So you can be assured that there were kangaroos in the ark. Now, why is there no mention of kangaroos in the Bible? Could it be that when the Bible was written, Australia hadn't been found, therefore, no mention of kangaroos? But didn't God create kangaroos? Isn't the Bible written through the hand of man, through the voice of God? Why wouldn't he mention the kangaroos? They're such an exciting animal. It seems to me that they only seem to mention things in the Bible that are within a 5-mile radius of the guy writing it. Like, if I was God, at the end of the Bible, I would have leant in and gone, oi, tell him it's round. Because didn't know the world was round. Fucking built it, didn't know it was round. Now, I dislike religious people. I didn't say that. We'll go back. Now, the thing is, what I hate about Christians is They start sentences like this. As a Christian. You can't start a sentence like that and explain to me that your the rest of your sentence has any more meaning than the beginning of the sentence. It means bullshit. That's a little fucking get out of jail free card shit you do. Right? Because I can't get in court and start a sentence like this. As an atheist. I didn't rape her. Didn't rape her. She was giving me a lift. Now, when I started this show, my first routine was about how lesbians were fat, ugly, useless, with no sense of humour. And you couldn't applaud more. Then I killed an Arab man from a fucking helicopter. Just shot him dead. Then I said that there's no that Christians are bullshit and there is no God. And that's the moment when half the audience chose to be offended. Was that the fucking moment that got you? How very Christian of you towards the Muslims and the lesbians. Next time, start your sentences with, well, as a hypocrite. Now, I'll tell you this last thing about you think you're a good person because you have Christian values. Do you want to know what Christian values are? Christian values are a load of shit. What are Christian values? The Ten Commandments. What are the Ten Commandments? Very sensible rules to live your life by. But you know what's a load of shit about them? The fact that you had to have them written down. The fact you couldn't figure out internally not to kill people. Don't steal. Really? You should just know these. These should be internal in you. The Bible is too wordy. All the stories are too wordy. The Ten Commandments are a load of shit. You don't need all these things. The Bible should be one sheet of paper. And on that sheet of paper it should say, try not to be a cunt. And if you do that every day, you'll be a good person. We try to sell this show to the Americans. I don't like our chances. So let's do something we can all enjoy. Sometimes when I'm fucking a chick, I go to fuck them again in the morning and they'll say something like this. No. When we fucked last night, it was a little bit dry and now I'm sore. Now, to any woman who said something similar to this, may I say, your problem. My job was to get an erection. Your job was to get your hole wet. Didn't you get your hole wet? We both had things to do. See, if I don't get an erection during sex, I'm called impotent. But a dry hole is the same as a flaccid penis. A dry hole is an impotent hole, and you're not a complete woman, and you should be ashamed of yourself. But women don't take responsibility for the dry hole. If I go to fuck a chick tonight and I get too drunk, which I will, and I go to fuck a chick and I don't get an erection, she'll go back to her friends and go, oh, I went to fuck that Jim Jeffries, he couldn't get an erection. But if I go to fuck a chick and she doesn't get wet, she'll go back to her friends and go, I fucked Jim Jeffries, he didn't even get me wet. You see the problem there? I'm in charge of everything. It's like, I used to fuck this chick for a while. I stopped fucking her. She sent me a text. I just stopped calling her. You know, just ignored her. And She sent me a text message a month later that went, oh, by the way, you never made me come. And I was like, really? You think you're the one who makes me come? Do you want to know who makes me come? I make me come! All the horrible thoughts I have in my fucking head makes me come. You have very little to do with it. You're just the container I shoot it into. But let's go back to the drug cunts. There are women in the room who are thinking, maybe I wouldn't be dry if there was a bit of foreplay. Let's explain foreplay. Foreplay is what we do to each other to get each other ready for sex. If I have an erection, that means I'm ready for sex. And I'm all foreplayed out. Now, the foreplay that's necessary for a woman goes like this. You gotta start by kissing them. Women love kissing. Men don't give a shit about kissing. We kiss ya because we like ya, and let's be honest, we spoil ya. But men don't give a fuck about kissing. Used to like kissing when we were in our early teens, then someone sucked our dick. And then, what's this kissing thing? Why am I kissing this person? Why would I ride on the swings? I've already been to Disneyland. But we kiss you because we like you and we're a charitable bunch. Then you start kissing down the neck. Now the whole time you're doing this, you're working downwards towards the cunt. Now you know you're going to the cunt. She knows you're going to the cunt. Everybody knows you're going to the cunt. But for some unbeknown reason, you have to act like you're not going to the cunt and that you're enjoying the journey of this creature. Women, you got to give them a journey. Men don't give a shit about a journey. If a man's driving from point A to point B, we fill the tank, we get on the motorway, we make good time. Right? Where women, you got to give them a fucking journey. Got to take them by the water or antiquing or some shit. So the thing is, women read so many magazines about how to send your man wild and how to titillate your man and all these 25 steps to do all these sort of fucking bullshit. Oh, you get a feather, involve food in the relationship. This is all bullshit. Play with these nipples. These things are fucking dead. They're dead to me. These mean nothing. You could cut these off and donate them to some poor African child without nipples. I wouldn't give a fuck. This is what we want you to do. Fucking suck our cock and cup our balls. And when you're sucking our cock, look like you're in a bit of pain because we enjoy it if you look uncomfortable. Anyway, but back to the lady. You keep kissing down. Now you're at the tits. Now tits are a mixed bag. Some tits you gotta be firm with, some tits you gotta be soft with, some tits you can bite the nipple, some tits don't even go near the nipple. Tits are like golf, you play the course you're on. You keep kissing down, now you're at the cunt. But even when you get to the cunt, you have to act like you're not at the cunt. You have to act like you've stumbled upon the cunt by accident. So you'll be kissing like a dimply bit of thigh here, and the cunt's there. And you have to sort of almost, oh, hello. I was visiting Dimply Thigh, I forgot you lived down here. Now always a pleasure, never a chore. Do you mind if I pop in? Then you lick the whole general cunt area. Then there's a bit at the top of the cunt. If you lick that, they seem to enjoy it. This all takes between 10 and 40 minutes. And she might be wet. And that's the foreplay that's necessary for a woman. Now, the foreplay that's necessary for a man. We just need to see you naked. Maybe you need kisses, caresses, compliments and licks. When all we need is you. Maybe we take our relationship seriously. Wasn't that a romantic joke? That involved the word cunt 15 days. Alright, we have to keep moving this show because I need to have a piss now. Because I've been drinking too much. I always get nervous before things like this, and so I got hammered in the dressing room. This is, the show's called Alcoholicos, and this, because I'm planning, because to me that means the death of alcohol, because I'm planning to stop drinking after this Edinburgh Festival. I'm not, you know, I'm not promising, but I'd like to, this might be the last DVD I record where I'm drunk, so the next DVD is going to suck balls. But the thing is, I call this show Alcoholicos, and now, because I live in America, some Jewish people have gotten offended by it. But I'm like, no, it's not like I'm at the Holocaust getting people drunk. It's just a funny word. I tell you what, though, I did a gig in Poland, and when I was out there, because I did a corporate gig out in Poland, I went out to Auschwitz. See, a lot of you uneducated people thought I was in Germany, didn't you? Auschwitz is in Poland. And I went out there, and apart from the concentration campy bit in the corner, the rest of it's delightful. It's a beautiful little village. I reckon their tourism board needs to get together and go, okay, we have a bit of a bad rap. Has anyone got any ideas? Hans, give it to me. Yep, that's true. We do have the biggest tower of secondhand shoes in the world. I don't know if that's a keeper. But write it down. Johan, even though that's a Scandinavian name. Pizza festival, you say. As we can cook 400 pizzas at once. This bit won't be in the DVD. Funny joke. I like living in Britain because my obvious alcohol problem is a problem here. Before I came on stage here, my manager, the last thing he said to me was, "Do you need another drink?" That would never happen in America. When I recorded my special in America, they employed someone to stand by the bar to make sure I didn't get wasted. Because Americans, they don't really drink like you people drink, like they think they do. But they're very into, like, drinking games. Which you people don't really have drinking games, right? Whenever, like, I'm out drinking in America, I always meet some, like college boy who'll come to me and go, "Hey, dude, ever play beer pong?" And I went, like, "What's beer pong?" Well, you gotta get a ping pong ball, you gotta throw it in the cup. If you don't get it in the cup, then you gotta chug your beer. And I'm like, well, let me just get this straight. I'm trying to get drunk. And you're putting an activity in front of me that may impede me from getting to my beverage. I said, they have a drinking game in England. Do you want to know what it's called? Drinking! And this is how it's played. What you do is, you have a drink, then you get another drink, you have a drink, 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 have a drink. You do this as fast as you can. And if you get so drunk that your friend has to drive you home, then you fucking win. How many more do you reckon there is behind me? There's a dwarf behind there mixing me a cocktail. I am fucking drunk now. Alright. I'm going to tell you a story. This story is very long. The first 3 minutes of this story are very depressing. I'm stitching up my pants. First 3 minutes of this story are very depressing, but there is a moment where this story takes flight. And you have to hang in there with me until this moment and trust me that the story is going to get good. I grew up at number 3 Taramara Street. At number 5 was my two best childhood friends, Andrew and Daniel Connor. Daniel was born with a disease called muscular dystrophy. If you don't know what muscular dystrophy is, it's a horrible disease that wastes away at your muscles. It's the same as Lou Gehrig's disease or motor neurone disease, except you're born with it. You get diagnosed when you're about 6 years old and you're not walking right, they put you on crutches. By the time you're 10, you're in a wheelchair. By the time you're 20, you're in a completely vegetated state. Most people die before their 25th birthday. Dan's lived to be 33 years old, still alive and kicking. Let me rephrase that. Still alive. He's actually died 7 times in his life and been resuscitated. 7! And I once asked him, I said, Dan, what happens after you die? And he said, nothing. So good luck with your religion and your faith. I'll take an actual statistic. Now, his family had since moved to Melbourne. I had moved to Great Britain. I went to do the Melbourne Comedy Festival. This is about a year ago. I hadn't seen him in all that time. His brother Andrew came to see my show, and then Andrew took me to see Dan, and I went in to see him. I'd never seen anyone live this long with this disease, and he's laying on a bed. His eyelids are a muscle that he can't keep open anymore, and he's just squinting through these little things. And he has a breathing mask on him to keep his lungs working because his lungs are a muscle that he can't keep pumping. He has a heart monitoring machine in case he flatlines in the middle of the night and someone has to resuscitate him. And as soon as I walked in and saw this guy that I used to run around with as a child, I burst into tears. There's nothing worse you can give anyone in this world than pity, you know? I went in the corridor, I felt like a right prick, and I was fucking wiping my eyes off. And I went back in, and I sat with Dan, his brother Andrew went off to work, and me and Dan chatted for a while. 20 minutes into the conversation, Dan says to me, Jim, I'm 32 years old. I've never been with a woman. Will you take me to a prostitute? And that's where the story picks up, ladies and gentlemen. Because I went, fuck yeah! Now you remember, don't tell my brother, he wouldn't understand. I said, that's where you're wrong. I've known your brother my entire life. Trust me, he will understand. And against Dan's will, when Andrew came home from work, I pulled Andrew aside and said, Andrew, look, here's the deal. Dan's asked me to take him to a prostitute. I'm going to do it whether you like it or not, but I think as his brother, you should come along and help out. And Andrew went, we're not doing it. And I went, why? And he went, it'll kill him. And I went, he's gonna die soon anyway. This is a good way for him to go, like, sure, we'll have to answer a few questions. And he said, we're not doing it. And I said, why? And he goes, because Mum doesn't like you already. And I went, your mum's never liked me. That's why I'm the right guy to kill your brother. And he said, all right, we'll do it, but he can't have full sex. Full sex will kill him. He can only have a blowjob. And I thought that was fairly reasonable. So we went back in and saw Dan. He was where we left him. And we said... Dan, here's the deal. I know you told me not to tell your brother, but I told your brother. Me and him are both going to take you to the knock shop tomorrow, mate. But you can't have full sex. You can only have a blowjob. And Dan went, I want full sex. And his brother Andrew went, Dan, you're in no position to argue with anyone ever. Then Dan reluctantly agreed. Now, prostitution in Australia is legal. So I spent the rest of the afternoon going through the phone book trying to find a brothel with wheelchair access. Best afternoon ever! Eventually I found one, the biggest brothel in the Southern Hemisphere, the Daily Planet, or as the Australians call it, Four Floors of Whores. It's a 24-hour brothel because Australia's a go-ahead country. So we decided we were going to go early in the morning, like real early, like 6 a.m. We wanted to go when the place was quiet and we weren't going to cause a scene. So we wake him up at 6 o'clock in the morning. It's hard to tell if he's awake. And we get him in his chair. Now, he hasn't got your bog standard fucking wheelchair. He's got one of those big sort of silver-looking things with the truck tires on it. I think the model's called a Hawking. And even though his muscles don't work, they get sore. So this thing can move him from side to side and back to front and even into a full bed. So we get him in the chair, then we order a taxi. And then it's not like you have black cabs out there. It's like a normal car, but they've modified the back to go higher. And they drive him up through the boot and they strap him in there. And he sits up high with windows all around him like a big retarded pope. Or as the Catholics would say, the Pope. And we drive off to the brothel. Now when we get to the brothel, it takes 10 minutes to get him off the taxi. I see this as my window of opportunity. So while they're getting him off the taxi, I run into the brothel. Now there's two ways the brothels work. Either the prostitutes will stand in a row in their lingerie and you just pick the one that you want. Or they'll stand around in a bar in evening gowns and high heels and you walk up to the one that you like the look of, chat to her for a bit, act like you've got some type of connection with an Eastern European woman, then take her upstairs and fuck her if you need your life to be this delusional. This is one of these situations, so while they're getting Dan out of the cab, I run into the brothel and go, everyone, quickly, gather round! I haven't got much time! And these 14 bemused hookers shuffle over and I went, look, here's the deal. I have a severely disabled friend with me. If you're not up for it, speak now or forever hold your peace. And one of them went, how bad is he? And I went, pretty fucking bad. And 10 of them said they wouldn't do it. And I said, well, I respect that. But can you please go and hide? Because I don't want him to be rejected by hookers. And these 10 girls shuffle away in their evening gowns and their high heels with gonorrhea falling out of them. I am now left with 4 girls, the best looking one by a mile stays. Dan wheels in, looking like Jabba the Hutt, breathing like Darth Vader. 2 of the girls run away and I'm like, are you fucking kidding, you sluts? I just asked you nicely. So we're now left with two girls. The best looking one's there, the other one's a fucking troll. Now out of respect for the ugly one, I go to Dan, I go, Dan, so only two girls working today, mate. Which one do you want? And he said, the one in the green dress. Now, neither of them had a green dress. I stand up and look at Andrew and went, what the fuck is all this about? And Andrew went, oh yeah, his eyes are fucked as well. Now, it turns out that Dan's colorblind. It's not part of the condition, it's just unfortunate. So, I sat with the hooker. Now, I'm going to pay for everything. Now, the reason I'm going to pay for everything is simple. I told Dan and Andrew that I would pay for everything as long as I got to tell this story to hundreds of thousands of people in the future. And they said, of course you can, Jim, but be respectful and change our names. Which sounds like the right thing to do now, doesn't it? Now I haven't changed their names. Their names are Andrew and Daniel Connor from St Kilda, Melbourne, Australia. I would have liked to have changed their names. It is the right thing to do. But I look at it this way. Even if I changed their names and their parents started watching my comedy, they'd be like, my word, doesn't Randy and Steve sound like our kids? Didn't Jim grow up with a lot of people with muscular dystrophy? So I sat there with the hooker and I said, how much for the half hour? And she said, 180. And I said, I'll give you 250 because I realise this is a specialty thing you're doing. And she goes, I got one question for you. And I said, shoot. And she went, is he mentally retarded? And I went, oh, yeah. That's what I do. I find mentally retarded people and take them to prostitutes. I'll be masturbating in the corner. He doesn't even know he's here. And she went, okay then, but if there's two of you, we'll go, no, he's not mentally retarded. It's his choice to come here. There's a good chance he'll die. And she went, what am I meant to do with him? And I went, I don't know. I've never been a hooker. But I'm thinking, give him a bit of a show. Dance around a bit. Rub your tits in his face. Then suck him off. But don't sit on him or fuck him. It'll kill him. So we go up to the room, which thank God was on the first floor. And me and Andrew look at Dan like two proud parents watching our child go to school for the first time. And then we leave, and as we proceed to leave, I pat Andrew in the back. I said, Andrew, you've been a good brother today. He said, thanks, mate. And then we had a hug. Then we had that moment after a hug that Australian men have where we go, oh, get out of it, what's wrong with you? And then I said, hey, Andrew, how does Dan get his clothes off? And Andrew went, fuck! And we went back in. Andrew looks him up and down and he turns to me and goes, look, he's very fragile. I know how he likes to be picked up. I'll lift him up, you take his pants off. Andrew gets behind, lifts him up by his armpits like I couldn't have figured out their magical hold. I'm on my knees taking Dan's tracksuit pants off. He always wore tracksuit pants, never got into fashion. And as I'm taking his tracksuit pants off, what many of you are wondering is, Can Dan get an erection? And the answer is yes. Even though none of the muscles in his body work, the cock is not a muscle, the cock is a bit of skin that fills with blood. If he gets aroused up here, blood will rush to there. Now, what nobody knew about this 32-year-old virgin is that Dan's packing heat. I'm talking 9.5 inches of disabled misery. This cock's so fucking big, I think that's why the rest of his muscles didn't work. I take the pants off, this thing springs up and hits me in the mouth. Then the hooker goes, let's do the light. Let's explain the light. When they legalised prostitution in Australia, they didn't legalise it in all forms. For instance, you cannot get a street-walking hooker, you cannot get a prostitute to your hotel room. You can only go to a brothel in a safe environment where they have security for the girls in case a man shows up being drunk and dickhead or whatever. And also, it's safer for the people who go to brothels because the girls get tested for STDs every month. So, arguably, you're better off in Australia fucking a prostitute than picking up a girl in a bar. But I'm not going to have that conversation again. Oh my, you try explaining that to a girlfriend, it's a fucking minefield. But also they make it safer for the girls. If you're a guy who goes to a prostitute, you have to undergo the light. Let's explain the light. It's very simple. Sounds like what it is. You put your cock under a very bright light and they look around the shaft to see if there's anything untoward. Then they get a magnifying glass out, go through your pubes to make sure nothing's running around. It's not a big deal. I've been rejected heaps of times. Now the chair's here, there's a bed here, there's a hot tub there, the light's over there. Now we try to get the chair past the bed and the hot tub, but we can't get it through. So me and Andrew walk over the hooker and we're whispering because we don't want Dan to hear and we're like, we can't do the light thing. And she goes, if you don't do the light, I'm not doing it. And me and Andrew went, ah. Come on. He's a virgin. What's the worst that can happen? And she whispered, actually, I'm more concerned about its cleanliness. And then his brother Andrew said loudly and proudly, I washed it before we came out. Now you may think you're a good brother, good sister, good mother, good daughter, whatever the fuck you think you are in this world, but you're nothing until you've washed your disabled brother's cock to take him to a prostitute. That is love, ladies and gentlemen. Tangible fucking love. So we looked at Dan. Everyone agreed it was time to go. We looked at Dan. Me and Andrew looked at him and went, we're going now, mate. Got anything you want to say to us, say it now, because we're going to leave, mate. And this is what Dan did. The bar and we hanged out with the hookers, like 10 of them sort of mulling around, and we're standing there I don't know what Dan's up to, but we're standing around the bar with all the hookers. And then five guys from London walk into the bar who are obviously out of their fucking skulls on coke. Now, if you've never taken a lot of coke, then if anyone's got any... if you've never taken coke, you know, when like five or six guys get together and take coke on like a Tuesday, there comes a point at about 6 in the morning where they go, well, you better call up some chicks, maybe, and you call up ex-girlfriends, like, bring some friends. So, I don't know what you're expecting. So, basically, I think it was a Wednesday we did this, and I think these guys have been on coke all night, and they've obviously gone, oh, okay, let's go down to the brothel, we'll go down to the brothel, it'll be fun, we'll go down to the brothel. And I'm standing at the bar chatting with the hookers, and these five guys from London walk in, and one of them recognises me and goes, Jim fucking Jeffries. Oh no, you mate, oh no, you the committee, the spaz approved guy, spaz the committee. And I went, hey, how you doing, man? He goes, hey, Jim. Want a lot of coke? And I went, yes. And I went up to the toilet and did a line of coke. I come back out, and obviously I've left Andrew alone for too long. And he's sort of panicking all by himself. And I sort of walk in like, what's wrong? And he goes, what if we've done the wrong thing here? What if he's in there dying right now? What if he stopped fucking breathing? Or what the fuck, his heart stopped? What the fuck are we meant to do? I said, not a problem. I'll resuscitate him. And he said, do you know how to do that? I said, no, I don't, but how hard can it be? Push, push, blow, blow. I haven't embellished that in the slightest. That's the exact thing I said to him. Push, push, blow, blow. Then the prostitute walks back in the room, who is with Dan. So I'm staying with the five coke fiends, 10 prostitutes. She walks in the room and it's like that moment in a movie where the needle on the record just sort of goes, and everything stopped. And she walked in and she said, well, it's over. And me and Andrew in unison went, is he dead? And her exact words were, oh, I didn't check that. So, me, Andrew, the five coke friends, the 10 hookers, we all run to the room. Now he's not dead. His chair's back in the upright position. His cock is still sitting up majestically, covered in chiz and spit. But for a man who an hour ago couldn't lift his eyelids, he was sitting there like this. Now you might be wondering why his eyelids are up like that. Let me explain something. It wasn't through happiness. Tell you something about myself. I'm 33 years old. I've been masturbating since I was 10 years old. And in that time, I have not missed a day. Every single day I masturbate, haven't missed a fucking day. Every day I'm in a hotel room with a laptop way high up on my chest here. So I don't have to look at the filth I'm doing to myself. So I'm watching porn here, and 9 times out of 10 I hit the Apple sign. Right? And I do this every single fucking day. Yet I would be mortified if any one of you was to ever see me doing this. I would want to fucking kill myself. And I do this every single fucking day. Now imagine if you've never ejaculated through the power of yourself. You've never had another person do it. You're 32 years old and for the first time you've shot a lot of fucking stale jizz all over the fucking room. And you're sitting there with your cock out and 15 strangers walks in. And you do not possess the power to put your cock away. Can you see how that might be a bit unhinging? So we had to get him dressed quickly. But there's cum everywhere. And this time I look him up and down. And I turned to Andrew and said, Andrew, I don't give a fuck how fragile he is. I'm taking the top half this time. And we lifted him up. And we put his pants on. And we proceeded to leave the brothel. Now, as we left the brothel, I turned to Dan. I said, Dan, I paid for a story. Please tell me what happened. And he said, well, she danced around a bit, rubbed her tits in my face, and sucked me off. This is what I asked her to do. It's so nice to be a disabled sex puppeteer. But even nicer than that, I used to have a preconceived notion on what I thought about people such as prostitutes, man, but I was wrong. That woman treated him with dignity and respect and made him feel like a sexual being for the only time in his life. You can't put a price on that. All right? Well, 180 is the exact figure. Then we go up front and we go to call a taxi, and the taxi driver who drove us there is still sitting out the front in his car, and he winds his window down and looks out and goes, I'll drive you home for free. I just need to know what happened. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good night.